I see skies of blue and clouds of white, the bright blessed day and the dark sacred night. I think to myself, what a wonderful world.
Child, Julia, welcome
well,
to
Jack,
Out of the Box.
I'm very happy to be here.
Well, I'm delighted to have you, and you, as I said, you're probably the best known authority on home cooking in the world. How did that happen?
Well, when I started in on the television, there wasn't anyone else cooking. So I had it all to myself for about 2 years. The first television cook was Dione Lucas, a very talented English woman. But when I came on, there was nothing.
And what was your background that brought you to television?
Well, after I got married, I started cooking with Joy of Cooking and Gourmet magazine, and then we moved over to France. We were in the diplomatic corps. My husband Paul had been brought up in France, so he spoke beautiful French. And we were in the embassy there, and I'd started getting interested in cooking, and when I got over there, I just couldn't get over that food. It was so good. And I decided that's for me. So I went to the Cordon Bleu cooking school in Paris. And luckily, I was able to join with a group of GIs who were on the Bill of Rights. That was in 1948-49. And they were getting 2 years of free education, so they chose cooking. You know, on the back of that book there, you see a picture of me and my old chef.
Well, this is the first book.
That's the first book.
This is called The Mastering the Art of French Cooking. And I like the way it describes it. The only cookbook that explains how to create authentic French dishes in American kitchens with American foods.
Exactly.
Yeah.
There's a picture of my chef, Max Bugnard. There he is right there. He just was a lovely man. He was in his late 70s then. And he had run a restaurant during World War II. And then when he came back, he started teaching at the Cordon Bleu. He was just a wonderful teacher, just a dear, darling man.
Well, and what would
Those
you say?
Those are my two colleagues there.
Uh-huh.
Simon Beck and Louisette Bertol. And that was our first book.
Would you say, Julia, that you were able to take the French cooking and translate it into the American idiom?
Yes.
So that it was, here you are an American and you've studied at the Cordon Bleu and you've adapted to the American lifestyle.
Well, because I was 30 years old when I started in. And so I had to really learn from the beginning. And so I really was translating French cooking for me and for other people like me who were starting in at the beginning.
Well, what a wonderful career, because you're going, this first one was 1961.
It was.
And this is the last one so far. This is probably what, number nine, number
10? That's number 10. That's our latest TV series with Jacques Pépin. We had 22 and we just had lots of fun doing them together.
Well, I watched some of those shows.
Oh, you did?
And it was so much fun.
Well, we had a good time.
Well, you have a composite of some of those shows, and I'd like to show it right now.
Well, good.
Good.
Like potato, and I like patata. You like tomato, and I like tomato. Potato, patata, tomato, tomato. Let's call the whole thing off. But if we call the whole thing off, then we must part. And Oh, if we ever part, then that might break my heart. So if you like oysters and I like oysters, I'll take oysters and give up oysters. For we know we need each other, so we better call the calling off. Oh, let's call the whole thing off.
Happy cooking.
Bon appétit. Today we're going to do soufflés, and as everyone knows, the heart of the good soufflé is...
egg white, beaten egg white, and I'm going to do mine in copper. I beat it faster than the machine.
Well, we're going to see if you're faster than the machine.
All right.
Okay.
Wow.
Well, have you counted? One,
yes.
Two, three, go!
I put a little bit of Parmesan cheese inside. What do you think?
It's not very tender.
It's not?
It tastes okay. I think that old-fashioned way
of boiling it
and squeezing it. You get it tender, and you don't get that slight bitterness. Mm. But you will do it either way.
I mean, in a more modern way, I tend to do it this way with less loss of nutrient and...
We don't care about nutrients,
we care about
taste.
Yes, but when you can have both together, you know?
But it's still a little... It's not very tender, and it still has a slight bitterness to it.
I think it's very tender.
Maybe you have sharper teeth than I do.
Most fish are expensive, and you have to go for quality. And quality means freshness.
And you should say that. I think that when you buy fish, they won't let you smell it up at the counter, but I always open the package a little bit and smell it.
Yeah.
And a fish should not smell fishy at all. It should have the fresh, oceany taste.
It is
and if it smells fishy or stale in any way, take it right to the manager and say,
smell it.
Smell this.
But I mean, if you want to do what we call tourner here, that is doing kind of little football shape, then you want to use a paring knife like that. This is what you learn in school. And take the smallest amount, of course, of the skin to give it that shape. And actually, you know, one cucumber is enough for like three or four people. You serve four or five pieces per person.
Mine isn't doing very well, so I'll eat it.
Good. Well, eat that one. It's not too good,
okay.
Too. I mean, the classic omelette is not better than the other. It's really different in texture and in taste. And sometimes you're in the mood for this, sometimes you're in the mood for that.
I don't know how this is going to turn out. We will see. That was rather messy.
Messy, but good.
Give me some more parsley.
That's what's important. We need parsley. We need parsley to put on top of it and garnish.
You always need quite a bit of something to cover up little problems.
Absolutely. I like to put the ketchup here with even a little more lettuce.
I press it. This is the top.
Press it.
One thing is, Jacques, when you get it so high, it's hard really to chew it.
It's true, you know.
It's so big.
You have bigger high than mouth, you know, most of the time. So I like to cut mine in half, you know, so I can at least grab a piece like this.
You might cut mine in half, too. That's a good idea.
Looks beautiful.
Look at that. Isn't that nice?
And now the best part of it...
is the eating.
Eat it, yes.
Okay.
Oh. Very good, huh?
That's good.
That's great.
Mm.
It's really good.
Real American fare.
And by, here we go. Oh, that's good, Chuck. I like that. Three, two, one, action.
This is a pestle. And in the south of France, when they make a fish soup, they make this wonderful garlic sauce called a rouille, which is garlic and olive oil, and they pound it in a great big mortar like this. When we were living in France way back in 1949, we found this in the flea market in Paris, and my husband Paul had to carry it about a mile. See how heavy it is.
Better him than me.
Today, Jack and I are doing desserts, and Jack is doing crepe Suzette. Woo! And I'm here to see that he doesn't burn down the house. Why, Jack, what a wonderful costume. Why?
Because I have all the ingredients for a Julius Caesar salad.
It's not Julius Caesar salad.
It's not?
Caesar salad, Julius version.
Oh, boy.
And we're going to do other things, are we?
Yes, we're going to do a whole array of different salad for you.
Good. Let's get going. Put on your goggles.
That's, yeah, I think it's a
who
good
knows
idea.
What's going to happen.
Not knows what's going to happen. Okay. That's it.
That's it. It oh,
oh,
look
at that,
that
egg. It's incredible. The yolk. Look at the, yolk. Look at the side of that
that's
yolk.
That's incredible.
My God.
Now we're going to scramble it, are we?
I can take this out now.
Yeah.
This is
beautiful.
Beautiful. I mean, look at the size of that quail egg next to it. So what we're going to do is you can make at least 4 or 5 omelettes of what we did this morning, or one of those big potato
oh,
omelettes.
A great,
you know?
Big one like this.
Yeah, I would say that this is probably, at that point, 1.5 dozen of eggs that amount to this, you know. And we're going to do a big either omelette or scrambled eggs or frittata with this, right?
It's going to take quite a while to make, Jack.
So let's relax and
let's
enjoy it.
Have a little glass of wine.
Yes.
And a bon appetit.
And happy cooking.
We'll probably be here next time still cooking this egg.
That was really fun. You look like you're really enjoying it.
Well,
I think that's part of what you do. You give a joy to this. To
well, it's a wonderful profession. I always encourage young people to go into it because you're with people who are passionately interested in what they're doing. And it's always fun to work with people who love what they're doing. And you wouldn't go into it unless you were passionately interested,
oh, of course,
too.
Of course. Well, I think that's what we say to all young people now. Make sure you're passionate about what you do because everything else will fall into place.
Exactly.
As long as you really love it. The worst thing you can do is do something you hate doing.
That's awful.
Yeah.
Well, the nice thing about the culinary profession now that it is being recognized as an honorable discipline. Because
yes.
It used to be you sent your child to college and then he or she went into the kitchen, you'd think you'd gone down a few paces. But now
now
it's a good profession.
Well, you're the icon. And you're the one
well,
that
you
everybody
don't have
follows.
To, you don't have to be a chef because there's so many opportunities. You can be a newspaper food editor or you can be a product developer. You can go into nutrition or something like that. So it's a large field and very much needed.
Yes, it is. What is your favorite food, Julia?
Anything that's well cooked by someone who knows what he or she is doing.
Well cooked. That means that doesn't mean
carefully
long,
cooked.
Carefully cooked.
Carefully
with love.
Cooked. As we would say, that they'd say in French, la cuisine soignée, which means careful cooking. Yeah.
Well, you took the in that film that we saw. They had. You had an ordinary hamburger.
Mm-hmm.
You made it look so good.
Well,
I wanted to eat it right off the television screen.
Well, I would too. I could eat another one right now.
We got a date. I'd love to have you make one like that.
Well, it's nice then that in this country, I think food is becoming a respectable and desirable occupation.
Yeah,
and people are taking food much more seriously and they know much more about it.
Yeah, but you're of the school that says you should really enjoy your food rather than having to eat a certain balanced diet. Ooh. Tell us about that.
Well, I belong to the American Institute of Wine and Food, and our logo is of moderation, small helpings, no seconds, no snacking, which is very important.
Yeah,
a little bit of everything. And a little bit of everything, because you don't know what you might be missing. And above all, have a good time.
So you're not pushing away the butter
oh, no.
and the cream
oh,
and,
absolutely not.
And all of that.
You should have something of everything, and you should thoroughly enjoy it. Because if you don't, you won't digest well.
But you know, that's interesting because with all the information we're getting on diets today, mm-hmm. and all the fad diets that I really want to ask you about, but I notice in France where cooking is an art, where
mm-hmm. certainly is.
It's very difficult to find a bad restaurant in France. Yet the French are not fat people.
Well, just see, they follow. They don't eat. I think when you go to a restaurant nowadays, you get these enormous. When we had lunch today, we had a Cobb salad. It was enough for
it was as big as this
three
table.
People. I just couldn't eat more than a third of it. It was so much. That's ridiculous because that can account for having these great big fat people that we have over here. But you go over to France and nobody, you don't see many big
fat
people.
No, you don't. You don't. You don't really.
And they exercise and they don't eat between meals.
Yeah. Well, so tell me, what do you think of these diets? The Atkins diet, the balanced diet, grapefruit diet, you know.
Well, I think if you follow those precepts of, you know, moderation and a little bit of everything, you don't need a diet.
So what you're saying is you should eat what you enjoy eating.
In moderation.
Don't eat huge portions.
Yes, exactly.
So that's the tip that
and
you
a little
would
bit
pass
and
on.
A little bit of everything I think is very necessary.
Yes. Yeah. Well, you ought to. How about vitamins and minerals and things like that? Do you need that?
Well, I think if you eat good fresh food, you're going to get what you need.
Yes.
And you want a great variety of food also, which is something else.
So that would be a balance of
fruits and vegetables
and fish and meat. But have it all.
Have it all, but in moderation.
I love that.
And enjoy it.
The moderation is the one I have the tough time with, Julia.
You're in very good shape, Jack, yeah. So I think that you must follow the right way of doing things.
Close as I can come, but I'm basically weak like everybody else.
Well, but you look fine, so I think you're doing the right thing.
I guess I'll just keep on.
Just keep on doing
it. You know, your life is so fascinating, mm-hmm. Julia, because you were during the war, it sounds so intriguing, you know, so exotic. You were the OSS, the Office of Strategic Services, mm-hmm. which preceded CIA.
Yeah, exactly. Well, I think it's hard for young people to realize that in World War II, that was in the early 40s, everybody, we believed in our country and everyone wanted to help, and we felt that we were saving the world. So everybody I knew and all my college classmates, we all rushed down to Washington or everybody signed up. So I had a fascinating war. And I was started out in the Office of Strategic Services in Washington, and then they were sending some people over to the Far East. So I volunteered, and I got over to Ceylon, now Sri Lanka, and to China, and it was just fascinating. That's where I met my husband, Paul.
In China?
In Ceylon.
In Ceylon.
So it was worthwhile.
Well, it sure
was. It was fascinating to be over there.
What was life like in Ceylon and in China in the early 40s?
It was very medieval. Mm. They didn't have any of the big buildings that we have now. And I remember Chongqing was just a small medieval city of about 500,000, if that many. And I remember if they had a fire, the fire department would put on its dragon costumes and dance around the fire because
really?
They didn't have the equipment to put it out.
That took care of the fire, didn't it?
No.
Well, you dance till it burned to the ground, I guess.
And now I think in Chongqing there are several million people. It wouldn't be at all the same the way it was. It was fascinating.
Nothing is quite the same, but food is a constant, isn't it?
Oh, that Chinese food was so good. I absolutely love that food.
I love it. Did you work in Oriental food?
No, I ate it with great gusto.
But
I've done a little bit of Chinese cooking, but my specialty is
French.
Is French and just sort of good cooking in general.
Well, what do you think of something like Wolfgang Puck, who took the Chinese and French and put it together?
Oh, well, he's wonderful. He's a real genius, I think, as well as being a charming man.
Yes. Well, the restaurant, the Chinois, is the most just unusual.
I love Spago in Beverly Hills that he has.
Yeah, I don't want one of your favorite restaurants. We got into that. Around the world. First of all, what city in the world is the best for dining?
Well, Paris, France. It's just wonderful.
Somehow I knew you were going to say that.
Well, I haven't been over there for several years, but they take they take food so seriously that, I mean, that it is really an art form. That's what really got to me when I got over there, that they were just, it was a very serious and lovely occupation to them.
You know, that's interesting, because I spent a great deal of time in France, and I noticed when the plate came out, it was such a gorgeous presentation from the smallest restaurant. Mm-hmm. It didn't matter whether it was one of the famous ones or a small one on a side street. The presentation was like a work of art.
Well, then also I think what I always love there is that the waiter is so much interested in what you order.
Yes.
So and you see two men having lunch, and they're studying the menu and discussing it with the waiter. It's a very serious business.
You mean it isn't like Los Angeles, where the waiter is really an actor and he's just filling in?
No.
He says, "I'm your no. My name is Bruce, and I'm your server."
No.
Yeah.
I think that's what really got me into it, was that the chefs that I worked with, it didn't make a difference how complicated and difficult something was. If they could do it beautifully, it was worth doing.
Are you an experimenter with food? Do you try?
Oh, yes.
Your recipes, are most of them recipes that you've created you've adapted, or how does that work?
Well, in the mastering the art of French cooking, those are classical recipes. They're all done, and I did it with my two colleagues, but it's the recipes that have come through ourselves and our ways of presenting them, so that you have your classical recipes to interpret, and then you have your own ways of doing things. I don't think anyone invents anything. You might invent puff pastry, for instance, but you're creating possibly a different way of doing something.
But you've written 10 books.
Yeah.
On cooking and with recipes
that,
and without it
prepared.
How is that possible?
Well, each one is slightly different.
Yes.
Because the recipes in the last book with Jacques Pépin, they're all mostly classical recipes, but each one has a slightly different slant.
Have you changed any over the years? I mean, how would you compare your cooking in 1960 to 2000?
I'm more conscious of, say, if I'm using butter,
yes,
butter and cream, of giving people the leeway to use less if they want.
In other words, you allow them to use less, but you don't recommend less.
Well, I think, particularly if it's a classical recipe, you should cook it the way it's supposed to be. And then, if it's a very rich one, just take a little bit of it. But you want it to be the beautiful way that it's supposed to be when it was presented.
Julia,
well, I think if you're going to worry about all of these problems, you're not going to enjoy the food and you won't digest well.
Well, think of all the time we spend eating.
Exactly.
It's the gathering place. It's where the family gets together. It's where friends get together. Mm. It's let's meet for dinner, let's meet for lunch.
That's lovely.
Let's meet for brunch. So, you know, when you come right down to it, that's really a very important part of our lives.
Well, it's where, as we often say, the family that eats together stays together.
It's a variation.
Well, I think it's very important. I think it's terrible to sit, say, with a television on the dining room table and have no discussion, because it's a lovely place just to talk and to get to know each other.
Well, this was our feeling. Ellie and I always with our family. We always had dinner. We always sat down together, and there was no television in the middle, and there was
it's just
straight
just
conversation,
yes,
and good food.
And then I think children have to learn how to eat. And I think if you're in the family when you're discussing the food, and the children help cook or help go out and buy, so that food becomes an important part of their life.
It's part of graceful living, isn't it? Well,
yes, very definitely.
Yes. Talking about graceful living, you've matured beautifully. It's no secret, it's in your books, you know, your age.
Yes.
Shall you say it? Or
I'm 87, going on 88, naturally.
That's remarkable. To what do you attribute this remarkable energy that you have?
Well, I used to say red meat and gin. Well, I love what I'm doing.
I like your style.
Well, I love what I'm doing.
Let's go out together.
And I picked my grandparents, who lived a long time.
You picked them well, huh?
I did.
You chose them
well.
Yep. Yeah, but even now, you told me about a new book that's in preparation.
Mm-hmm. Well, I've got two new books, really. I have one, we're doing one, which we're going to call, sort of the working title is The Iscus, they picked it, The Essential Julia, which is a quick reference book for good cooking, that you just, a little book which you have in your kitchen and you can look up
what
anything.
What a wonderful idea, like a handbook.
Yeah, they're like a little handbook. If you've forgotten how to do a butterflied leg of lamb, for instance, or you want to poach some fruit in white wine and you've forgotten what the proportions are, you just look it up in this little book and there you do it.
So it's a handbook, it's the essential Julia.
And then the other book, which I'm going to do a memoir of our life in France, because we went, Paul and I were in Paris for about 10 years from about 48 on into the end of the 50s.
What a perfect time to be in
France. And he kept a journal, and he was a wonderful photographer, so I've got hundreds and hundreds of wonderful photographs.
And they're going to go into a book.
So that will go into the book.
And what will that be called?
We don't know yet. You think of one and we'll use it.
Okay. Will I get credit?
Yes, definitely. Yeah.
So, what are your goals for the future now? Is there anything special that you'd like to do that you haven't done?
Well, just keep on. And
just keep on trucking, huh?
Keep on trucking. And then what I love is that it's being in the culinary business, it's like a big family because we're all together. I've just been to a big conference of food writers and cookbook authors and teachers called the IACP, or the International Association for Culinary Professionals. And there were 1,500 of us in Providence, Rhode Island. It was just a wonderful conference. We had seminars and feasts and all kinds of things, and then met everybody. And it was just, it's like a big family, so it's a wonderful profession to be in.
Well, I think what's wonderful, Julia, is that you are so accessible. When I go out with you, as we did for lunch, and everybody talks to you about food, and mm-hmm. you answer with such grace, and there was the parking attendant in one place was really a pastry chef.
Yes, you know? which was fascinating.
And you made some suggestions about where he could go and what he could do, and it was just...
Yes, I had just been to a restaurant and their pastry wasn't good, so I suggested he go to the restaurant.
You're putting two ends together and making it work.
Well, it's a good profession because we all know each other and help each other out.
So how would you compare the cooking from around the world? Italian cooking is very much in mode
that's
today.
I think unfortunately people are afraid of French cooking because I think of all that butter and cream and so forth. But if you go over to France and take a look at them, you don't see those great big fat people plodding around the way we see over here at Disney World. They're trim and walking and... So I think the way they eat is much healthier than we. And they don't have these enormous portions that we have.
Yes. Well, you're really an education. Knowing you is a marvelous thing, and you've added so much to the grace of the United States of America in bringing the French concept into the kitchen.
Well, we're doing wonderfully in this country. We've got world-class wines and we're having world-class restaurants and chefs and cooks, and I think we're doing very well.
Great. Julia, you're a world-class lady.
Well, thank you,
welcome.
My dear.
Welcome. Thank you for being
thank
here.
Thank you, Jack. I've enjoyed it.
I've enjoyed
trees
it, too.
Trees of green, red roses, too. I see them bloom for me and for you. I say to myself, what a wonderful world. I see skies of blue and clouds of white, the bright blessed day and the dark sacred night. I think to myself, what a wonderful world.